Okay, so this is going to be the first video where we talk about some of the fundamentals of forging. So now, in this one, I'm going to talk basically about the kinematics of forging, heavy deformation. Basically, this is the idealized deformation. And we did this also with axial, but it was rather simple, so I didn't spend too much time on it. But you'll see actually the way this works with torsion, as it did in axial, and also when we do bending, is we're going to assume some idealized type of deformation. From that, we'll be able to get the strains and then the stresses. And you can balance those internal stresses with the external applied forces. In this case, they'll be torques. And that'll give you the relationship between the external force and the internal stresses. So last time, when we did axial, it was the fact that each section stretches and stays in the plane. From that, we got that the external force, or I should say the internal reaction force, P, is related to the stress. Internal reaction force over here. Okay. Now, when we talk about torsion, I've got this piece of tubing here to kind of help illustrate torsion. So, what I've done here is what I've done here is I've drawn some lines straight down the tubing. The tubing's supposed to stay straight. And also a couple of circles around the tubing. So you can see those lines. Cross sections. Now, when we twist the tubing, you can see those lines. Feel the lines twist, but actually those circular shapes stay circular. So those circular cross sections are like discs, you can imagine those, and they stay in the same plane basically. There's not any deformation significantly out of the plane. That's like, if there is, that's what we call warping action. Right? So that's the picture you want to see in the book actually probably. All right, so if you look down the end, but each one of those as we put a torque on it, this disc, originally they were lined up at 12 o'clock in the morning. I imagine this was fixed. As we put the torque on it, this disc will rotate. This angle will rotate. What we're called feet. And actually, the amount that it rotates. See that here as well. As I twist this, right, the discs going down further are going to rotate more. Okay. But we assume that everything stays in this plane with the discs. So this, each one of these discs basically rotates rigidly. Okay? There's no warping in the disc. It just stays circular and it just rotates. It just rotates. Now, as you move down, speed will probably increase. Down further to another disc. Like, start here, but it actually might go that much. See that those lines that are on that like twist it, right? They stay pretty much straight. So that's the angle of twist. That's the picture we want to get in our heads with our butt first. Now that angle of twist, if you want to think in terms of an analogous quantity with regard to the axial deformation, that's like the displacement, okay? So it doesn't really directly measure the amount of strain, the amount of distortion going on here, but it's more related to the integral of that, you know, how much actually deflection there is. In this case, it's the torsion, so the deflection is that amount that this rotates. Alright, so again, that's not really the strain. Now a couple other, just to do some terminology here, we also are going to want to deal with the radial distance. Book uses finds the radial distance with the blue letter rho, that means the distance from the center, and the outer radius it calls C, so that's the outer. Okay, now what we really want to look at a little more is we want to get at the stresses, not quite at a point where we get the shear stresses yet. So to get that, we want to first start thinking more along the lines of what is the associated strain of this type of deformation. Now for the axial stuff, that was the stretching, so it was a normal strain. Now in this case, it's going to turn out to be a shear strain. And remember the picture we get for shear strain is initially of the material, there's shear forces acting on the faces, balance each other out, and the way this deforms, traps it, right? That's the definition pattern. And this angle here, that angle, gamma, is the shear strength. That's actually the measure of the shear strength gradient. Okay. Now, if we go back to our tube, see what I've done up on top here is I've drawn a couple of little patches here, like a Mondrian painting or something. Now, as I torque it, you will see the shear strain pattern. So each one of those discs, like you can just look at these two, this one, this disc will rotate, and then this next disc will rotate a little bit more. So this one has a rotation angle of B. This one has a rotation of angle of B plus a little bit, right? You'll see. See a little glare out there. So there's no glare there. Look at, there's the square pattern. It's like torque, right? You can see that that becomes that trapezoidal shape. So actually, we've got a third hand, but you can kind of see it there. See there's a line underneath. Like if you were to draw a straight line from this point down here, you can see that that forms an angle as is the point of this edge. Okay? That angle is the shear strength. Okay? That is the shear strength. So if you look down on the top. So you can see sort of the angle that that cube makes with the straight edge. That's the shear. So you're looking down on the top of it, right? You have at least that two, right? You have a torque acting in this direction, that direction. So here are the two discs. This disc rotates by T. This disc rotates by T plus a little bit. So the square forms this shape. This angle here, that is the shear strain, okay? So that's what we want to start looking at. All right, well, we've outlived the usefulness of the tube, so let's go to some of the pictures of the book. These are a lot nicer. But now that you kind of see how this goes, here's a figure in the text. So here is a, basically our tube, this one's solid, and put a torque on it, T, acting around the x-axis. Here are two cross-sections, just like I've drawn on the tube. And distance from the center outward is rho, that's the radial distance. This one disc is at x from the back, and then on this next disc. So the differential length from there, x plus the delta. Now here's a little chunk of material. Now this isn't necessarily drawn at the surface, it's got some distance of rho. Take that, blow it up. All right. So here's the back disc, right? This moves by an angle of B. It's tough to see here, but this angle here is B of X. Remember, the distance to here is X. This distance here is delta. Okay, so this moves B of X. This is the undeformed plane, okay? So this back circle rotates from this edge by angle B to this edge. Now, if we move up a little bit, now this edge, right, starts up here, moves that same angle B to this edge, but then, because it's advanced a little bit, it's going to twist a little bit more, a delta T, okay? So this angle here is basically how much more, twist this, right? That's the way it is, right? Okay, so B is the amount this disc rotates relative to my hand. Assume this is X. And then dB is how much more this one rotates relative to this back. Okay. Now, a pop, you can see this is the deformed shape. Here is the patch on top, okay? This is, when I'm drawing there, kind of red. That is the shape that this square patch becomes, a trapezoid shape. And here you can see the angles, the sheer angle B. So this allows us now to relate the sheer angle gamma, I'm sorry, I called it B, the sheer angle gamma, through to the angle of twist, or how much the angle of twist really changes. So if you look at this, the way we do this now is, this segment here, that arc length is the same for both angles. So we kind of redraw this. I just draw this just to see those arc segments. Yeah. This angle here, D delta phi, that's how much the front plane has rotated relative. This is the back shear angle on top. This distance here is delta x, right? Delta x distance. And this distance here radial distance from the road. So this arc length here from this triangle is equal to rho delta, right? That's how we can get this arc length from this triangle. You can also get the same arc length from this triangle. It obviously has to be equal. And that would be delta x times the shear angle gamma. Alright? Just find these arc lengths to be the same. So we have this relationship between the change in angle of the two disks and the resulting shear strain. Now, we can see some dx, some differentials here. So if we divide through by the dx, we can get a thing that looks like a derivative. It gives us rho delta p over delta x equals engineering shear strain gamma. And then as we take the limit, as delta x goes to zero, this just becomes a derivative. So we get rho times derivative of p, angle of twist, respect to x, that equals shear strain. Okay, so this is an important relationship. This, you know, as I mentioned in class, whenever you see these equations, you know, you have to think about physically what they mean. Don't just memorize the little symbols. That's useless. You have to think about what each symbol means. So what's going on here? Well, here we have the shear strain. So obviously the shear strain is an important quantity. That's going to relate directly to the stresses, right? If I know the modulus of rigidity or the shear modulus G, I can get the shear stress right from gamma. What's it related to? Well, it's related to how much the angle of twist changes with respect to x. So how much, you know, so if I look at this little square on top, right, and two disks twist a little bit relative to each other, or they twist more with respect to x, you can see the shear strain goes up. So it's proportional to that, which I think is pretty obvious. Most people would imagine that. But the other one that it's related to is rho, the distance from the center. You can see that. So let's look at this next picture that illustrates that. So not only is the shear stress here related to how much this disc rotates relative to this disc, but how much that angle p changes with respect to x, also related to distance from the center. So here are two of those distorted discs, like here are the two shear shapes, right? And both of those have different shear strain angles. This one gamma, this one actually gamma max. At max, one turns out to be altitude. Okay? You can see this is greater than this angle. As you take this down to rho equal to zero at this point, you can see that then that shear angle also has to go to zero. Even though dp dx is the same for these two disks, okay? So obviously it depends about how much the two disks twist from each other, right? That's the thing. But also, as you move closer to the radius, shear strain gets smaller, going to zero. It increases linearly until you get the maximum value at the outer surface. Okay? So we have this relationship, and we also get the maximum one, right? The maximum shear strain happens when rho goes to C. When we talk about the radius being the outer radius, maximum shear strain happens at the outer surface. This is going to be equal to C instead of rho. Dx, right? Okay. So that's kinematically what's going on, right? Twist it, the discs stay in the plane, they rotate. And then relate the shear strain to the amount of twist, how much the twist changes with respect to x, but also distance from the center, OK? So unlike axial deformation, where the shear strain was the same across the whole face, we have a radial dependency. Okay? Don't forget, rho, radius. Okay? C is the outer radius, but rho is actually a radius. Probably a lot of people might want to think that maybe R, but the book calls it rho. Okay? All right. So we've talked about how much physically this thing deforms. We've talked about the type of deformation, the idealized deformation, the kinematics. What we need to do next is take this shear strain. We can obviously then relate that to the shear stress through the shear material response, right? Now, if we have a shear stress, that shear stress has to balance these external applied force, or I should say really the internal reaction. So what we need to do next, in the next video, is find a relationship between tau and the internal reaction force, T. Okay, this is going to be the torsion equation. This is probably most useful because we're going to use that to relate the internal reaction torque to the actual stresses. This is going to be the analogy of P over A for axis, right? P over A, we're going to have to do that. Okay?